morning from my side, and welcome to City University. I don't have to do a sales pitch, Alex did it for me. So I will actually focus on the topic that I wanted to discuss today with you. The first one is scaling. You know, most of you are developers, you are makers, you have your own companies, and at one point in your life you would like to grow your business. By the way, I have a little bit of a policy when actually talk, I expect people not to be on their laptops. And I'm one of these professors who actually goes back in time when I'm saying, no devices in my class. And you know how wonderful the students take this kind of remark. They hate me for this kind of thing. And I say, guys, if we're going to do it, we have to be here. We have to be present. We have to look at each other. This is the most important thing. And why am I saying this? Because learning is about being here. You know, you can do the learning in your laptops or the devices when you go back home. So what I would like to actually touch upon very briefly, because Alex told me that I have 45 minutes, so I have to stick into the schedule, is about scaling up and the problems that come with the scaling up. Everybody, you know, thinks that it's great to scale up, it's great, you know, to grow, but nobody actually considers the problems. So this is something that I would like to talk. The first one is, what are the problems when we're scaling, and then how do we remain innovative? Because as you maybe have imagined or maybe have experienced, as we're growing older, what happens? As the company grows older, what happens?
More problems.
More problems. As the company grows in size, what happens?
Bigger problems.
As the company becomes more successful, what happens?
Bigger problems.
Absolutely. I'll tell you what normally destroys companies. Success, age, and size. Success, age, and size. That's it. And a lot of people don't care about those things, so they don't want to focus on those things. That's why they're expecting somebody else to tell them about this. Why success? Because success may turn into
failure.
Yeah, that's the outcome, but what is the mechanism to reach failure? I'm successful. What am I doing when I'm successful?
Complacency.
Overstretching.
Yes. So whatever attacks, I become like Midas. I think in my mind, whatever attacks is going to become?
Nobody will know Midas.
Gold.
Thank you. So it will become gold. That's the first thing. So it's complacency, it's arrogance. And actually, I'm one of these weird academics. When I'm saying weird academics, what do I mean? I spend a lot of time in companies. So I don't spend a lot of time in my office. I have a very nice office without a window, but it's nice. But I don't spend a lot of time on it. I spend a lot of time in the field. This is where you learn, spending time in the field. So the first thing is success. The second one is age. What happens as we grow older? What happens as the companies grow older?
Become slower.
Yes, slower.
Don't know what we're talking
about.
Get stuck in?
What you've learned so far.
Yes, in certain ways. Okay, great. And what happens when the company grows in terms of the number of employees that we have, number of staff?
Bureaucratic.
So most probably you have seen all these manuals, you know, these handles that it starts with the top, and then there is a line, it has the other, you know, then there is another line, then there is another line, then there are more boxes, other line, more boxes, and then go forever. And so what is the problem there? The problem, again, is about how long it takes for information, how the culture is changing. By the way, in terms of age, there's something interesting, because I'm working on a project currently on curiosity. Curiosity drops with age. A four-year-old daughter asks their mother 400 questions per day. How many questions do you ask per day? Okay, you can think about it. You don't have to embarrass yourself by answering. So you can think about it. So it's a mess, and as Alex said, I'm based here in CAS. I'm professor of innovation and entrepreneurship. I'm also an associate dean for entrepreneurship. We spent a lot of time on this. I was born in the 70s, but for people who are trying to calculate my age, I'm going to save you the cognitive power. I'm 46. Okay. So when I was a kid, I was a tinkerer. What does it mean? My friend was the screwdriver. I was destroying everything. My parents at one point stopped buying me stuff because I had the room full of junk. My problem was that I wanted to see how things were working. Fine, right? Everybody wants their kids to know how things work. But my problem was to put them back, making them work. then this is the time where I realize that knowledge is important. So it's interesting to have this, and it's interesting to keep this, because this is how we actually learn, by uncovering, by delving deeper into subjects. Now I'm doing the same thing with theories, or with what I'm doing in terms of working with companies. Yes, I said this. I'm also an advisor in a company that offers hedging solutions. What is the hedging? How they can hedge commodities, currencies, and everything else. So this is a company that was started by two ex-hedge fund managers. It's very customized. It's very mathematically driven. They have their own algorithms and their own formulas. And every client, which is a big corporate, they want their own solution. The problems remain. It's always about people and money. And it's always about what happens when you're growing, that you're losing something. And I'm going to give you more examples. I'm also part of the fund that we have here. So we have a venture capital fund at Citi, at CAS. It's 10 million we invest into companies. And it's interesting because one of the portfolio companies came, and they were talking about the strategy. And then the CEO thought that the company is not working, or it could improve by buying another company. The company doesn't work, and they are going to solve a problem by adding another complex problem, which is buying and integrating another entity. Okay. So this is something that I want us to discuss. What happens when you're going to grow? And since I was saying that I like everything that, with the screwdriver, I guess, I like everything that has speed, that gives me the adrenaline rush. Normally, academics don't die. They die from boredom, so you need to find something else to counterbalance, for instance, the boredom. So this is something that I'm doing. Today I would like to talk about three things very quickly. It's a mess when you grow, and you have to realize this, okay? And I'm sure I'm not the first one who says this. I'm going to maybe repeat some of the things that you have heard in the past. The most important thing is, how do we remain our, how do we keep our creativity? How do we keep our innovation while we're growing? Because again, we are losing it. And the first thing is the mess, leadership. You are growing. You have more people. And what happens? What normally happens is people want to add things. What normally doesn't happen is people, they don't want to get rid of stuff. So what do you end up having? A lot of stuff. So the handbook is 2 pages in the first couple of months, then it becomes 200, then it's an encyclopedia. So what is the problem here? What do you have to do is you have to stay focus on something. So if you had 5 rules, again, what do I mean? You have to deduct, Don't add, get rid of stuff. A lot of people are adding, and then they are saying, but why are we doing this? Or why don't we get rid of this? Because there's budgets. We used to do this. So because we used to do it, we have to keep it. You have to keep it. Okay, so there is an emotional attachment. Basically what we are doing is that we are hoarders. No, it's hoarding stuff. Okay, this is very bad, and that's why I'm raising this from the beginning. So stick to something which is rules, very few, then spread the mindset. It's very important that everybody knows. Everybody knows what is happening. So what is your role while you're growing the business? You have to do the business, which makes your life very difficult, and at the same time, you have to talk. And you have to be seen that what you're saying is also what you are doing. You cannot be contradictory. If I contradict myself, nobody cares, because it's costless. But if you contradict yourself, everybody cares. What you say and how you say it and how you respond to some situations is under the spotlight. You know, it's a magnifier glass. So it's very important to do this. In terms of the team, again, this is something that I noticed. Bigger teams. You go to meetings, you don't know other people. You don't know why you're in the meeting. You don't know how you plan to contribute to that meeting, how your knowledge is relevant, and you still go. And I have a lot of people who are saying to me, as an advisor or as a consultant, we don't have time. And I say, of course you don't have time, because you are going to all these unnecessary meetings. Unnecessary meetings. Is this true? How many times have you been to meetings where you had no idea what they meant? Thank you very much for your honesty. I appreciate your honesty. Me too. And then I did something very radical. I never went back. So I said, this is not for me. I'm not qualified to do this. I'm not coming again. Okay, find people who are qualified to do this kind of things. So it's important to keep the team management. What kind of size of team do you think is good? How many people?
4 to 5.
7.
7 because you said the 7 years.
Keep clean. Yeah. Yeah.
You have to accept.
How many do we have in our team?
12?
Do we have
too many.
Too many.
Too many.
Too many.
Too many.
This is for them. It's
not fair.
4 to 5.
4 to 5, yes.
Is it around 25 so everyone could like know each other's name and.
Yeah, it's more like a studio mentality. So you need to know everybody. So a lot of companies that have a lot of few people, they create those studios. So everybody knows each other. But in terms of work, it's 4 to 5. And the best teams are the teams of 2. And why is that? Because you cannot hide. I have been into meetings where there are 4, 5, 6 people. You do a brainstorming session, and you know what? Brainstorming. You have heard of this, right? And you know what happens? How do you know when people are lazy in brainstorming sessions? They repeat other people's ideas, or they're very silent. Okay, so again, this tells you something. You require people to speak their minds, of course, sense of accountability. I own the place. I have been to a company in Silicon Valley because I'm doing a lot of research in Silicon Valley, and when you enter their lobby, they have a very nice green, let's say, wall, and everybody, all the employees, have signed in that wall. All the employees. So it's part of who we are. It's our identity. Pure meetings, this is what I was saying. I hate meetings. And I wrote something about this. It was very nicely received. And so we have to deal with it. Then as you are growing, you have to actually hire more people. I will give you 2, let's say, bios. This is the first one. And then I would like you to tell me which one you would hire. Don't ask me for this job, for which job. You can decide. I'm going to give you 2. This one, read this one first. Bio send signals. What kind of signals do you get from this? Who is behind this? Yes? I'll give you another one, but before, you're reading this. What are the signals that you are getting about this individual? What are the cues?
Self-motivated?
Yes?
Smart?
Smart?
Brave?
Brave?
Didn't turn out well in the end?
Are we talking about the political? Okay. You remember this, then I'm going to show you another one.
This is you.
No, it's not me. I wish it was me. I didn't make up stuff. Which one would you offer the job, or would you like to have another meeting to learn more about? How many of you would like to have another meeting with the first one?
Depends on the job, no?
Oh no, of course I said. I said this from the beginning. It depends on the job.
Exactly.
Figure out a job. Create one job. It doesn't matter. And it's not for the job. It's for whether we understand what is happening here. So how many would go for this one? How many would go for this one? You would like to find out more information about this one? Okay. Hey, how many would like to learn more about this one? Okay. And there are some who are undecisive, indecisive. They haven't made up their minds yet because I know it's Friday, it's very early, you need time. Okay. The first one is Ted Bundy. Ted Bundy. So, you know Ted Bundy is a serial killer, very notorious in the US. So the political, let's say, affiliation, aspirations, it wasn't only his only problem. His problem was that he was, a serial killer, basically. The second one is called John Hunter, who is a Scotsman, and he's referred to as the father of modern surgery. Okay. So it's interesting how things are. When we have to make a decision, which means that you have to make decisions quickly when you are doing those kind of things. And sometimes you don't even make the decision. Somebody else is making a decision for your, let's say, on your behalf. So we have a team, we have the leadership, then what do we have? We have the recruiting. We need to find people who are good, not serious leaders. This is the moral of the story. And then the incentives. Who is getting rewarded? What do you reward? Good performance? Amazing. But is this enough? What should you be rewarding? Good performers as well as people who help each other. Okay, team players, you are growing. You don't want prima donnas. You know the expression, right? You don't want egocentric individuals. What do you want? Individuals who are very good in what they do and who are also going to help other people, who are going to support other people. For me, because I have worked with a lot of top management teams from startups, scale-ups, large organizations, and I'm not saying this because I'm an academic, the best leaders are the ones who want to educate, who want to develop their teams. And why am I saying this? Because this spreads like a virus. So the people in your team are going to do this with their own teams. So their people are going to do with their own teams. So it spreads. So what am I recommending, just to finish this, let's say, section? Do a pre-mortem. Not a post-mortem. Post-mortem is too late. Do a pre-mortem. So what does it mean? Try to anticipate different scenarios. So a scenario that, you know, growth plans are working and the company is successful, and try to see, you know, what is working, but also do the opposite. The company will be failing. Then you take some steps backwards. So what have we done in order for us to fail? Or what can we do differently? So why am I saying this? Because a lot of times we have to anticipate. I'm a big believer of losing on paper. What do I mean? You get your team and you start creating some plans. No money. Just your thoughts and your team members, okay, your colleagues, and try to create a plan, okay, of how things may be working out. So this is extremely important. But also think of why things may not work out. Why am I saying this? Why am I recommending this? Why things may not work out?
Stop learning. Risk management.
Learning. There is an optimism as we grow our business because we're successful. We have more investors. We have clients or customers who love us. So what does it mean? We live in a bubble.
Yes, like assumptions.
Exactly. So we have to challenge our assumptions. We have to challenge our knowledge. So it's important for us to actually do this. What may go wrong? I'm a big believer of thinking of the worst case scenario or what will happen. Because, by the way, most of the time it does happen. Okay, the worst case scenario. So, have you heard what is the problem with scale-ups or large organizations? Or, you know, scale-ups from these organizations which are expanding, which are growing, and then they're losing something. These are products from Apple. Newton was the first tablet, the pencil. That's why Steve Jobs created the pencil, because this was a flop. It was a failure. And this was a camera that Apple had. This is a camera. Did you know about this? Some of you may knew, some of you just learning today. So all these are the products that Apple used to have at one point. Well, they were growing. Okay. And this is from BlackBerry, a tablet. BlackBerry, do you remember this company? They used to do devices with the keyboards. Do you remember this? Okay, I'm exaggerating to make a point. BlackBerry was not a mediocre company. BlackBerry was an amazing company. It was a leading company. Okay, so it wasn't an average company. How many of you used to have a BlackBerry? How many of you still have a BlackBerry? Don't raise your hand. Try to avoid social embarrassment. Okay. But you understand what I'm saying here is that things do change quickly. Or the phone from Amazon. Okay, they still get it wrong. Okay. So why large companies have problems? This is something that I started talking about a little bit earlier. First of all, most of them do not understand what hit them. So how the situation, how the landscape is changing. So that's the first thing. Let's assume that you understand what is happening. It's very difficult to change, to navigate differently the Titanic. Because what you are doing is not, you are not having a rib, okay, a very small boat. What you are having is the Titanic. It's very difficult to change this. So some of them cannot see how the landscape is changing, but some of them who can actually see, they find it very hard to reallocate resources. Okay, so that's the first thing. Leadership, again, is problematic most of the times. Structures, this is something that I was saying earlier. The structures, you know, people become very attuned with what you are doing. They would like to remain the status quo. They don't want to be challenged. They don't want somebody else to come and say, you're doing this wrong, and because they're afraid that they're going to lose power. So this, again, something that acts as a stabilizing force. And the other one is that they don't attract innovators. There's a difference between invention and innovation. Okay, and we can explain this. But for me, innovation is about commercializing. It's applying invention. So for instance, I did an interesting research on Xerox PARC. Have you heard of that company, Xerox PARC? It was the R&D lab of Xerox. They were based in Palo Alto, and they have invented a lot of interesting things, such as the Ethernet, the graphic user interface, and other stuff. It's very interesting because they didn't manage to make a lot of money from it. Somebody else licensed their technology. So they managed to get this. So in a way, what they're trying to hire is people who are interested in power, in politics. They want to avoid, let's say, risk, and they want to do the traditional way of market research. I'm not against this, but what I'm saying, this is not the only solution. They will have the fair share of inventors, people to do stuff, but they wouldn't have a fair share of innovators, people to commercialize stuff. So that's the difference. Do you recognize this? That's Kodak. Kodak actually invented digital photography. This is the guy who invented it. He went to the board and then he said, I invented, you know, the digital photography. Great, the digital camera, great. It was something like a toaster, 2 kilos. The resolution of the digital photograph was 0.000 something, doesn't matter. But then the board said, this is a lousy idea. Because analog photography, it's much superior, which is, by the way, true. Okay, and they said, do you know how much money we make from films? Do you know how much money we make from cameras? So the business model doesn't work. So what did they say? No, how do they make money now? By licensing their technology to other companies such as Apple and HTC and the rest. The same happened with Blockbuster. Netflix went to Blockbuster. Did you know about this? Netflix went to Blockbuster. And they said, can you help us with the offline presence? We can help you in the online presence. So synergy. Synergistically, can we work together? Can we collaborate? And the big guys said no. Who will actually, you know, get those kind of DVDs and movies at that point from an online presence? Everybody wants to go to the offline stores because they also get other stuff, such as ice creams and soft drinks and the rest. So the business model again was very interesting. For me, creativity is the first thing. It's about generating ideas, and innovation is about implementation, execution. Okay. A lot of people are asking about innovation, and I like this, but I also like another definition, which is the recombination of existing knowledge. Apple is an amazing, let's say, example of innovation. It's the recombination of existing knowledge. So you don't have to actually come up with something. What do you have to do? You need to have your antennas on, scan the environment, and try to see how you can recombine whatever is out there. So incremental is something which is interesting. You see the first iPod, and then what you see is iterations. So the phases that you see there, they're very incremental. So what does it change? Maybe the size of the drive, maybe, you know, the color, something like this. The breakthrough is when you have BlackBerry and then you have the phone without the keyboard. As BlackBerry was saying, Research Emotion, which is behind BlackBerry. So Research Emotion was saying, but who is going to buy, you know, a phone without the keyboard? Professionals, they're never going to buy. Okay. So again, it talks about how difficult it is for some people to realize where it's going. It's not about what I think, it's about what the market wants. Okay, that's the difference. So breakthrough is very difficult, but it's better for startups. Why? Because they have there are very few people. Most of the time they have a hypothesis to test. If it doesn't work, it's fine, then we're going to do another test, something else. And I don't care if it doesn't work. The others do care because they're going to lose a lot of money if it doesn't work. And of course their R&D, which is quite small, puts them very close to, let's say, the market. So I know a lot of entrepreneurs who are very close. I'm also teaching executives from my companies. I had a CMO, a chief marketing officer from a big company, and I asked them, you know, who is your client? And they say, the response was, we get a very nice report from a market research agency. I said, okay, not helps, right? So you lose touch with reality. That's the problem. So they're not losing touch with reality. Now, to go back to what I was saying earlier, how can you stimulate breakthrough innovation while you're growing? You can work internally, or you can get some help externally. So the first strategies are to do it yourself and then to go to the market. So the first thing is you need to carry on putting stretch goals. Oops, I'm destroying city property. So you need to do stuff to stretch the goals. Again, you know, if you say to people, let's increase our sales by 2%, loser. Who's going to do it? It's not ambitious enough. You don't change how you think. But if you say we have to, if you give them, let's say, a very difficult, of course I'm saying not overwhelming, but more challenging one, then people start thinking differently. So what are the problems that we have identified? Is there a trend? So a lot of companies, what do? They follow trends. AI, for instance, is a trend.
Robotics.
Okay, all these kind of things. For me, it's a very good word to use in your business plan or your pitch deck to increase your valuation. And for other cases, it means business. So these guys know what they're talking about. But most of the time, says, is there something that we haven't anticipated yet? And then, is there a trend to actually, let's say, follow? The Apple Watch is an interesting toy, but not a revolution. Swatch executive. I'll share with you a very little and dirty secret. When you read statements about new technologies, new products, new services, and people use the word toy, these are the things that are going to become mainstream. Whenever, because the same thing I have read from a reporter in 95 who said exactly the same thing about the internet. The internet is a toy. Exactly the same thing. VR, a lot of people are saying, VR is for kids. Augmented reality is for kids. Whenever you hear those comments, that it's for kids, it's a toy, get involved with that technology. Okay, so it's very important for you to know this. Everybody actually saying this. What use could this company make of an electrical toy? Toy, 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 kids, kids, kids. What do they want to do? They want to ridicule the new technology. They want to underappreciate, underestimate. And of course, us, quite clever, what do? We actually listen to this. So the second thing is you need to hire more creative and innovative people, people who are going to break the rules. So we had a guy who was working in a large organization. He came to actually upset a little bit of the system. Then he said, we need to go to these conferences. We need to actually start developing these products. And then he asked, is there a budget for those things? And then the controller said, no. Do we have a code for this thing? No. So what did he do? He developed his own code. And he started putting all the expenses into this particular code. 2-3 years. Nobody knew about this code. Is this legal? I doubt it. Is it account in terms of accounting correct? I doubt it again. But did it help him to actually achieve his goals? Yes. And after 2 years that he actually showed what he has done, everybody was, okay, now we have to sort out the accounting mess. Okay. But what is the interesting thing is that you want people, and I'm not recommending for you to start playing those games, but what I'm saying is that you have to figure out ways to think in a different manner. So it's important to get these kind of people. Also design products for customers you don't have at the moment. So who are your customers that you don't currently have? Who do you anticipate entering, you know, this particular space? What would their needs be? So I personally invested in a company that has credit cards for kids, because it's a friend of mine, I know them quite well. So this is a market which was not covered by traditional banks, so it's a couple of startups who are doing those kind of things. So it's interesting to know that these kids who are having these credit cards, of course we could load money, it's not like unlimited. You have to load the money and then they can use the money that you've put into the card. But these customers are going to actually become your own customers if you are a bank, for instance. So the banks haven't thought about this because they haven't thought of kids as the primary target segment. And that's the card I'm talking about. Go ahead, let's go. The third thing is the grow labs. I'm in favor of doing this. Labs, give them a budget. Not a lot of money. I'm a big believer, and I'm not saying this because I'm an academic and I'm risk averse, which I am, is because if you're waiting for a long time to innovate, then you have to spend a lot of time, a lot of money and time, and it will either work out for you or not. So what am I saying in plain English is that you have to take a big gamble. So I'm not in favor of big gambles, I'm in favor of little tests in order to see how it works. So of course Google has Google X, that we are all familiar with doing all these crazy things. Some of those who are that are going to become mainstream, as I was saying earlier. Idea markets, I love the suggestion box. Bottom up ideas. And I've been to a lot of meetings when the senior manager is saying, we have only the ideas. They're sitting in their very nice office or in the meeting room, you know, closed doors, and they're saying, we have the ideas. Okay, what I would like you to think is put back the suggestion box and for all these kind of things to go bottom up, from employees to senior management teams. Moonshine projects are interesting projects that happen after work. Okay, and Google 3M used to have the 20% rule, that 20% of their time people could actually use it for things that they cared about, but they were also relevant to the company. Then Google actually adopted this, and it was a little bit of a mess, mixed findings about this. And some mistakes, they're very important, and critical, let's say, detail, but it's very critical, is fund them separately. Because what happens, if you put the money into one pot and then something happens, do you know what is going to happen? Forget about this little project. We need the money for this important thing. But if you have it somewhere else, this money always stays somewhere else. You don't touch it. So you either have to do it physically, when I'm saying physically, don't hide it under the pillow, but physically in terms of, you know, this, or mentally, you know, culturally, you have to set it aside. Most of the times, if you put it in one pot, it's gone. It will never go back. The other thing is, and this is something that I have been working for 15 years, become ambidextrous. Who is an ambidextrous individual?
No one can.
You are. Mm-hmm. Amazing. This is the first time I'm meeting somebody who's ambidextrous. Thank you. I've never met an ambidextrous individual.
Well,
okay.
It doesn't mean
you can use both hands with equal dexterity. So we use it metaphorically in terms of organizations, and there are several definitions. If you want, I can send you more stuff if you are interested. In terms of how you can exploit current markets with current products, as well as explore new markets with new products. Okay. What is the difficulty about this? When we talk about exploitation, we're talking about efficiency, minimizing costs, not taking risks. When we talk about exploration, we're talking about imagination, taking the risks, and investing a lot of money. So what does it mean? The one contradicts the other. So the goal, they're always, you know, into war about this. So, and you have to deal with this. Now, normally what happens is that you have these two units. So for instance, this is like the, imagine that you are Apple. So these people are doing, for instance, the computers, and these people are doing the new things. The App Store, the iTunes, you name it, the tablets. So far, so good. Are you with me?
Yes.
When I shout, you know what happens. I want a response, a very nice, positive response. Okay. But this is my style. But so what happens here? There is a problem, though, because these people have to talk to these people. And sometimes it doesn't work. So this has to be, because these products that are created here, at one point, they will become a mainstream product. The money that we will be making, the extra money from here, they're going to feed new products. So this is a loop that never ends. Now, the contextual is the 3M that I was saying. Let me say you another story to actually to refer to this point. When I started doing my PhD, long time ago, I'm entering a particular company, a design studio here in London, very famous. So what are they doing? They're doing corporate identity, in plain English, brands, for big corporates. How much do they charge? Half a million, 2 million for one logo. And then they said, if we actually hire people from strategy consultancies, McKinsey, Booz Allen, BCG, then what we could do is we can charge more. We have 5 minutes. Yes? I can finish with this story.
Cool.
Yeah. So, and that's a fantastic story to finish with. If we actually hire these consultants from multiple consultancies, then we can charge more and they can understand better the client. Okay? I said that's fine, it works in my head, but then we have to see it in practice, you know, to see it in action. So, I entered, for instance, the field the first day, which is the company, and something interesting strikes me is that on the ground floor they have a very nice reception, meeting rooms, conference room, a very nice cafeteria that offers breakfast, lunch, and dinner, for obvious reasons. On the first floor is the designers. Do you see this? The designers who used to be there. And on the second floor, they have the newly hired strategy consultants along with the top management team. I was very young. Not short, very young. Okay, I was very young. So, and very naive, I have to say. So I said, okay, that makes sense, blah, blah, blah. So I started interviewing, and because I'm doing a PhD in business, I'm given an office, a space with the strategy consultants on the second floor of the top management team. So I'm starting to interview them, I do observations, and then at one point, I asked the strategy consultant, one of them, and I said to him, I think that I have enough information from here, and I think I need to talk more to the designers. And the guy turns to me and he says, yeah, that's great. I think you're absolutely right. You have done a lot with us. Why don't you start exploring them? But I have one advice for you. Don't go downstairs after 6 o'clock because they get together and they do drugs. Fascinating, right? I'm 24, fascinated by the whole thing. For the whole night, I cannot sleep. I cannot sleep. I can think myself Forbes magazine, the Fortune, the first academic who is going to write about drug consumption and abuse in the workplace. I would be paid, you know, hefty fees to talk to companies. I will become a star. Okay, this is what I'm thinking. The following day comes, and because I'm a cheeky Greek, I do my thing, and then I go after 6 o'clock. In my biggest disappointment, most of them are gone. Some of them are, you know, finalizing their drawings or tidying up, and the others, you know, are still working in teams. So I'm disappointed. No money, no Fortune magazine, no Forbes, no fame, no speaking fees.
No drugs.
So, no drugs. Nothing. Biggest disappointment of my life. That's why it's. I still remember this after, you know, how many years. And then I start interviewing the first designer, the senior designer. And he says to me, what do you do? Where are you from? What do you study? Blah, blah, blah. And then he says to me, where are you based? I say, upstairs. And then he turns to me, he says, with the suits. Because consultants were wearing suits. That was the difference. Okay. I know that Alex is looking at me to stop, and I'm going to stop. But for me, this is a very nice story to finish something, which is while you're growing, you have to actually deal with some things which are very uncomfortable. And you have to prepare in order to go to the next level. That particular example that I'm finishing today is a good example to show you that this company was not prepared to get the new people. This is what I was saying earlier. Okay, thank you.
We just need to reboot the system before Rasmus comes on to give his next talk. But, Kostas, yes. I don't know if you'd like to stand up here while we do the magic behind the scenes. If anybody had any questions for Kostas, then please fire away. I know why you're missing those meetings now.
Yes.
Yeah.
And the emails now.
And the emails.
Now yes. The problem is extending to emails as well.
Yes. Any questions for Kostas? Okay. Simon, this.
So, is there any more thinking around like sort of designing organisations for scalability? Because I think like the Jeff Bezos model is quite interesting, isn't it? Of like the small teams with defined interfaces, so they can just scale up. Is there sort of those ideas being developed and formalised more?
There are studies and in the research about how you can scale excellence. And they have done this, for instance, with chefs. Because it's very difficult to scale, you know, cooking or to scale something that it's that requires a little bit of craftsmanship. But I think that to go back to the point earlier, a lot of things are about behaviors. So while you're growing, you have to deal with behavioral issues. So a lot of things have to be actually addressed before growing. So what am I trying to say? So assuming that you start realizing that people start stealing from your company, what do you do? And by the way, stealing doesn't happen in a way of, you know, money. You know what happens? They take pencils, they take notebooks, they take photocopy paper for their home printer. They start taking this stuff because studies have shown that people, it's very unlikely for them to take money, but it's very likely for them to take things which are very far removed from money, but they have a monetary value, right? So how do you deal with this thing? Do you allow this? By the way, do you allow this to actually happen as you are growing? Because what happens? Studies have shown that if I do something and nothing happens, this becomes a norm. So just to give you an example, there was an experiment done in the US. So what was the experiment? Well, the experiment was that they tried to figure out cheating in exams and whether people will cheat. So imagine it's a lecture room and they're giving a multiple choice questions. The person who was doing the experiment realized that in order to do all the multiple choice, they have to take 20 minutes. After 20 minutes, they will go to the academic and they will say, I'm done, and the academic will give them money. That was the experiment. One person in that particular group is an actor. He's paid to actually act as a student. And he's instructed to actually go to the invigilator, the academic, and give his script after 20 seconds, which means that he has actually cheated. Okay. And what they wanted to do is to see whether others will follow. Okay. The only difference is the hoodie that the actor is wearing. What do I mean by this? If the actor is wearing the hoodie of their own university, then cheating goes up because it becomes a norm. When the actor is wearing the hoodie or the, let's say, the jersey of the competitive university, cheating goes down. What does it mean? He is not one of us. The other one, he's one of us. Does he go unnoticed? He does. Let's all of us do it. Then it becomes a norm. So for me, while you're growing, the first thing that you have to realize is that you have to change a lot of things at the behavioral level, if I'm answering your question. Indirectly.
Indirectly.
What a wonderful place to stop. Anyway, thank you very much, Costa.